So the endocrine system has a whole series of feedback loops that help control which hormones produced when and what effects it might have on the body. There are two kinds of feedback mechanisms that we find in the human body. There are negative feedback loops and positive feedback loops. And as I talk about these two, I want you to think about which one do you think is more common and which one is most important when we are trying to maintain homeostasis. So here we have an example of a negative feedback loop. And a negative feedback loop is when the reaction to a stimulus is to stop the stimulus. So let me give you a physical example. When you reach out and touch a stove and you feel that it's hot, the stimulus is the stove is hot. Your reaction is take your hand away so that that stimulus stops. This is a negative feedback loop. Here is a great example in the human body. Here we have normal blood glucose, and it's sort of shown as this teeter-totter because it can go down or it can go up. So let's say it's the morning and you just ate two donuts for breakfast, and now your blood glucose is elevated, and your body wants that to go back to normal. The elevated blood glucose is going to trigger the pancreas, in this case this is our gland, to produce a hormone, insulin. And most of you guys have heard of insulin. What insulin does is it triggers cells to open up their proteins to take up sugars. This touches almost every cell in your body and says, okay, time to open up those glucose channel proteins. The glucose leaves the blood, goes into the cells, and we get back to normal blood glucose. So this is a classic negative feedback loop. The stimulus causes a response that reduces the stimulus. Now, as a sidebar here, most of you guys have heard of diabetes. There's different kinds of diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is people whose body does not produce insulin. There's different ideas about this, but it looks like it might be an autoimmune disease where your own immune system attacks the cells in the pancreas that produce insulin. So now, if you have type 1 diabetes, when you eat two donuts, your body doesn't know that it should take up that glucose. And so people who do this have to give themselves shots or use a regular pump to insert insulin because they aren't able to do this negative feedback loop themselves. People who have type 2 diabetes, that's actually a different situation. Type 2 diabetes is when you do produce insulin, but your cells don't listen to it anymore. Imagine you've been eating two donuts every morning for 25 or 30 years. Your blood glucose is almost always elevated, and you're almost always producing insulin. And it's a little bit like the story of the boy who cried wolf. Your cells are just tired of listening to insulin, and so they start to ignore it. And that can have some serious health consequences with permanently elevated blood glucose. You get increased blood pressure, can lead to blindness, loss of sensation in limbs, and eventually amputation of limbs. So there's all kinds of problems with this negative feedback loop not working properly. We have a completely separate negative feedback loop for when your blood glucose gets low. So let's say it's the morning, you decide to skip breakfast and you haven't had any lunch, your blood glucose is going to start to get lower and lower. That's also going to trigger your pancreas to make a totally different hormone called glucagon. Glucagon is a hormone that will then go to your liver. It will cause your liver to release a sugar called glycogen. Glycogen is easily converted into glucose that gets back into your bloodstream and stabilizes your bloodstream. So we have two negative feedback loops, and if these are both functioning, it will keep your blood glucose finely tuned at just the right levels. A positive feedback loop is when a reaction to a stimulus is to increase the stimulus. We have an example here in childbirth. So here we have a woman who's about to have a baby. Baby is head down and ready to come out. As the baby pushes down right here on the cervix, it's going to cause stretching. And that stretching is going to send a nerve impulse up to her brain. That nerve impulse is going to go to the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus is going to send some hormones that will then trigger the pituitary to produce a hormone called oxytocin. So here we have one gland triggering a second gland. The oxytocin is going to move through the bloodstream and it's going to reach the muscle around the uterus and it's going to cause that muscle to contract. That contraction is going to cause the head to push harder on the cervix, which is going to cause more nerve impulses to the hypothalamus, to the pituitary, more oxytocin released, and this continues. And so when you hear about someone having a baby, and at first the contractions are 10 minutes apart, and then 5, and then 4, and then 3, what's happening is this positive feedback loop. And the only end to this process is when the baby is actually born, and it stops this whole cycle. Now, someone who is ready to have a baby but has not started labor, one of the things they can do is give them an oxytocin drip. So this is an IV with oxytocin. So hopefully you can see when you're given an oxytocin drip why that would speed up the birth process significantly. That can be tough on the mom because you go crashing through labor here and you can have a baby very quickly. Oxytocin is an interesting hormone as well. Besides just doing this trigger here for birth, it's the hormone that helps you feel bonded to other people. And so when you finish all this, your body's flooded with oxytocin, you're not making contractions anymore, but it's going to help you get bonded to that brand new little baby that you're snuggling. So hopefully you've thought about which one is more common. The negative feedback loop is really going to help us with homeostasis. It's going to maintain that constant environment. A positive feedback loop is sort of spinning out of control, and that's not really what we want to happen in the human body. And in fact, giving birth is one of the few normal examples of a positive feedback loop in a living system. Just as a review, look at the negative feedback loops that are presented in your notes and make sure you can identify the glands, the hormones, and the target cells. And next, we have a short video for you to watch to review the endocrine system.